morning, church. Let's pray the prayer for illumination. Gracious God, give us humble, teachable, and obedient hearts, that we may receive what you have revealed and do what you have commanded. Amen. Today's scripture lesson is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 4, verses 1 to 9. Adam made love to his wife Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. She said, "With the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man." Later, she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now Abel kept flocks, and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. And Abel also brought an offering, fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it." Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out to the field." While they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother Abel?" "I don't know," he replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Okay, good morning, church. We are continuing in our series that we started last week, the series on a legacy series. Take out your sermon notes and let's prepare to go to the Lord in prayer. Wonderful Jesus, wonderful Savior, mighty God. Lord, we just commit this time into your hands. Lord, may you continue to speak to us, Lord. As we open our hearts and our minds to hear from you, Lord, may you speak to us about our lives, about the things that we are doing, about the legacies that we are leaving behind. Lord, we just commit this time into your hands. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, so we started this series last week and we asked the pertinent question, what legacy are you leaving behind? All right, and before that, let us just define what legacy means. All right, this is my definition of legacy, so that we are all on the same page. This is my definition of legacy. It is the influence we leave behind after we are gone. The influence that lingers on, that we leave behind after we are gone. Gone doesn't mean die, okay? Gone is, it could be when you leave a certain place, when you leave a certain season in your life, when you move from one organization to another organization, and of course, when you die, okay? But the question is, when you are gone, when you are away from a place, what is the influence that you leave behind? And last week, before the introduction, last week, we saw that it is so that if we don't do anything about it, we will leave a negative legacy. And because we saw last week, you know, that we don't have a choice, you know, that whether or not you choose to, we will all leave legacies. All right, it's not a choice. We don't have a choice. All of us will leave a legacy. And that was what we saw last week. And after that, and we also saw last week that there's a warning that godly people can leave ungodly legacies. That godly people can leave ungodly legacies. And so just don't think that just because you're sitting here, you're comfortable, you're living your life right, that you will automatically leave a good legacy. No, chances are you will leave a bad legacy. And this morning we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about how people leave bad legacies. What are the bad legacies that we leave behind? And next week, we'll talk about how to leave a right legacy. But before that, before we go there, you know, last week, some of you are wondering, after last week's sermon, not many of you will admit it, but many of you are wondering in your heart, why do I need to leave a good legacy? I mean, after all, nothing to do with me, what? I'm gone already, ma. Why do I bother? Why do I even need to bother whether or not I leave a good legacy? I mean, after all, it doesn't affect me. Well, for the simple reason is this. We need to leave a good legacy because as a Christian, as a community that God left behind to show His glory, we cannot claim to be followers of Christ and then leave a bad legacy behind. You just can't do that. It's just antithetical to our being, to whom we are. And you just go back to history, go back to the first person that God created, to the first humanity when humanity first started, when God created Adam and Eve, okay, there was just a couple, alright, there was just a family, and then God kicked them out of the Garden of Eden because of sin, and then they gave birth to a children, and suddenly now, not just is there a family, there begin the forms of a community. The community begins to form. And we know the story that was read by their sister, the story of Cain and Abel. Cain was the elder brother. Cain was the firstborn. And then along came Abel. And of course, it's sibling rivalry, lah. But there's a lot more than just sibling rivalry. You know, Cain was the elder brother. Cain was the one that came before. Cain was the one that ought to be the one to leave a legacy to Abel. And this is what it says. You know what happened to the story, right? Because of jealousy, they were arguing. I mean, Cain offered a sacrifice to God. God said, not good. Abel offered a sacrifice. God loved Abel's sacrifice. And the two of them, you know, jealousy. And in the end, what happened? Let's read in Genesis 4:8. It says again, now Cain talked with Abel, his brother. And it came to pass, when they were in the field, that Cain rose up against his brother and killed him. Then the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel your brother? He said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And these words haunt humanity from that day onwards. Am I my brother's keeper? You know, Cain blatantly killed the brother, look at God and say, so what? Am I my brother's keeper? You know, this was the first relational sin. A relationship was destroyed because Cain only cared about himself. I'm not responsible for my brother. I don't care about him. I only care about myself. And because Cain only cared about himself, about how I feel, what goes through in life, how I experience life, how I enjoy life, all that matters is me, not my brother. I don't care how my life impacts others. I don't care how my life influences others. Am I my brother's keeper? Am I responsible for my brother? Well, the answer is simple. Yes. You can write the first point of your notes is this, that though we can choose to ignore our legacy, it is our responsibility to leave a godly legacy. Yes, you can ignore it. Yes, you can choose to leave a bad legacy. You can don't care about your legacy. You can just live your life the way it is and leave behind a terrible legacy. You can do that. But it is your responsibility as children of God, as people of God, to be our brother's keeper. In other words, friends, you cannot not be bothered about the influence you leave behind. And that's what the church is all about. That's what living a Christian life on earth is all about. You know, after all, why are we here on earth? If it's other than to leave a godly legacy to the people that's after us, to leave an influence of God behind after we leave. Oh, what other purpose is there for us to be on earth? You know, if it's just to go to heaven, I always say, God should just kill you and send you to heaven. But God left us on the earth for a purpose. And that purpose is not for you to enjoy life. That purpose is not for you to enrich yourself. That purpose is not for you to make yourself a name and be famous and be whatever. That purpose is to leave a legacy, an influence, a godly influence, not a bad influence, to the people around us. And that's what Paul said in Philippians. You know, when he was telling the Philippians, he says, you have to be responsible. You cannot just live your own life. You have to be responsible for the people around you. In Philippians 2:4, he says this, let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. And that's what Paul is saying. Your life, it matters. The way you relate to others matters. The way you are responsible for the influence you leave behind matters. And Paul says it in a different way to the Romans. To the Romans, he said this to them. In Romans 14, he says, "For if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. By what you eat, do not destroy the one for whom Christ died. So then, let us pursue what makes for peace and mutual upbuilding." You see, what Paul is saying, it's not about food. Food is not important. Whether you eat, you don't eat, that's not the critical issue. The critical issue is, what influence are you leaving behind? What influence is your action doing? Is your action influencing people to upbuild and to pursue for peace and mutual upbuilding? Or is it otherwise? And so, friends, it's not a choice. Since the beginning of time, we are meant to leave a responsible legacy to the people around us. But many times we don't care, right? We don't care. And without realizing it, just because we don't care doesn't mean it doesn't affect us. It affects us in more ways than we can see, more ways than we can think. You know, a story is told of this little mouse. You know, it's a little mouse who stayed in a barn, in a farm. And one day, the farmer's wife received a little package. And the mouse, peeping from the mouse hole, saw that package and said, "Wow, what delicious cheese is inside that box. Maybe it's a nice little cake the mouse can't wait to eat." And when the mouse, to his horror, the wife took out a brand new mouse trap from the box. The mouse saw that trap and he was panicked. He said, "Oh my goodness, it's a mouse trap." Straight away, he ran all the way to the barn, went to see the chicken, and tell the chicken, "Oh, chicken, 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 the farmer's wife just got a new mouse trap. I'm in trouble, she got a new mouse trap." The chicken looked at him and said, "So what? Nothing to do with me, ma. I'm not your keeper, I'm not responsible for you." Shoo! The mouse, poor little mouse, ran to the barn next door, ran to the pig and say, "Hey, pig, 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 you know, the farmer's wife just got a new mouse trap. What do I do? What do I do?" "Mouse trap, nothing to do with me, ma. Your problem." "Shoo! I'm not your keeper." Then one day he ran to the cow and say, "Oh, Mrs. Cow, Mrs. Cow, you know, the farmer just got a new mouse trap. What do I do?" "Say, mouse trap? Shoo! Nothing to do with me. Doesn't affect me. Shoo!" Later that night, as the farmer, they were sleeping, suddenly the mouse trap went piak. The farmer's wife heard it and stopped and thought that something was trapped. Went up to the house to check the trap, but because it was dark, she didn't realize actually a snake got caught in the trap. The tail of the snake got caught in the trap, and in the dark, the snake bit the farmer's wife. Poison. Straight away, the farmer brought the wife to the hospital, but it was severe. So there's nothing much they can do. So the farmer brought her wife back to the house, and the fever was rising, and the fever was getting worse. And you know, in those days, right, in a farm, when you have fever, what is best for fever? Chicken soup. So the farmer went to the barn, took the chicken, choo, and you have chicken soup. After a while, friends and relatives start coming to visit because they know that the wife is sick, and they start come pouring in to pray together and to just be there with the farmer's wife. And now there's so many people around here to feed them. So he went to the barn and he took the pig, and we had char siu for dinner. And after that, a few days later, the farmer's wife actually passed away. And when she passed away, even more people came. The whole community, the whole village from far and wide all came to the farmer's house to pay their last respects. And as a poor farmer, he had to feed all these people. The only thing left was the cow. And he slaughtered the cow. And the mouse, little mouse, looked at all these people and wondered, "Aren't we connected? Aren't we responsible for one another?" And sometimes we just don't realize that. We just don't realize that we are connected and that we are responsible for one another. And many times people with that kind of attitude, with the attitude of the cow and the rabbit, the cow and the chicken and the pig, we won't leave a good legacy. We'll leave a bad legacy. And so, friends, the question now this morning is, how do we leave irresponsible legacies? Because if we don't see ourselves as being responsible for our brother's keeper, as a brother's keeper, be responsible for our brothers, we will ultimately leave irresponsible legacies. So three ways we often leave irresponsible legacies. Number one, in your notes you can write, number one, the first is by leaving lifeless monuments instead of life-giving memories. By leaving lifeless monuments instead of life-giving memories. You know, one of the saddest verse in the Bible You know, in the Bible, they always have these one-liners. After a life of a certain people, there will be a one-liner that like kind of summarize some things about that person's life. It's like the epitaph of that person. All right, and there's this one-liners in the Bible about most people's life. There will be this one-liner, and one of the saddest epithets that you will find in the Bible is of the person named Absalom. Absalom, you can go back and read the book of Samuel. You know, Second Samuel. Absalom was David's son, and he murdered his brother who raped the sister out of vengeance. And then he tried to overthrow the father, King David. And then he led an army against King David to kill King David. And in the midst of that army, somehow the war turned against him, and he died. He was murdered in that. He died in that battle. And after the whole story about how he died, the book of 2 Samuel ended his life with this verse. In verse 18, Samuel 18, verse 18, it says, "Now Absalom, in his lifetime, had taken and set up a pillar for himself, which is in the king's valley. For he said, I have no son to keep my name in remembrance. He called the pillar after his own name, and to this day it is called Absalom's monument." And that's all that's left. One pillar. Alive. That is of rebellion, of murder and all that. And the only thing he can leave behind is one pillar. And you think about it. Many people in the Bible, many other examples in the Bible, where they left not good legacies, and all that is remained is a monument, a lifeless monument. King Solomon was one example. We know his legacy. We saw it last week. You know, at the end of his life, the one-liner of his life says, "And Solomon did evil in the eyes of the Lord." And what is his legacy? The only thing that he has, the monument that is Solomon's temple. That's the monument he built. And you can build a huge temple to glorify God, and that will be your monument. By the end of the day, if your legacy is that he lived, he did evil in the eyes of the Lord. What legacy is that? Another example is King Herod. Not in the Bible, but King Herod was the King Herod that when Jesus was born, when the king that tried to kill Jesus, he too built another huge monument. And that monument is the second temple. The first temple Solomon built was destroyed. And later on, King Herod built a new temple for the Jewish people. And that temple is the temple that was there when Jesus was there, when Jesus was born. And his legacy, nobody will remember him for building that temple. But everybody remembers him as the king who tried to murder baby Jesus. That's his legacy. The monument, all that's left today, you go to Israel, is that one wailing wall. You know the wall that everybody go and talk about praying? That is the wall of the temple that Herod built that was destroyed. And that's all that's left. A lifeless monument. But on the other hand, you look at the life of Jesus. Jesus, after his years on earth, he never left a single monument. In fact, he never even left any writings. He didn't write the Bible. The Bible was not written by Jesus. It was his disciples who wrote it. Jesus did not leave a single monument. But yet, when Jesus died, he left memories. Lives that were impacted, lives that were influenced for generations to come. Friends, if you want to be responsible about the legacies that you leave behind, put efforts to leave not monuments, but inspiring memories. You know, we Chinese, we always have this habit, you know, they say, we must leave enough inheritance for our grandchildren. I don't know where their culture comes from, you know. We always have this mindset, you know, that we need to leave enough inheritance for our grandchildren. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that as Chinese, we should not, we should not do well and leave inheritance that is enough for our grandchildren. Nothing wrong with that. The Bible even says in Proverbs 30:33, I say a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. Alright, so it's biblical to do so. But what I'm saying is this, you know, don't let your legacies be just the inheritance that you leave behind. Don't let your legacies just be the wealth that you leave behind, but let it be the relationship you built when you finally leave. You know, sometimes we can get so distracted in the pursuit of good things in our life for our family to the point that we miss out the really important things. You know, at the end of the day, friends, let your legacy not be the house you leave, but the home you built. Let it not be the education you provide, but the life lessons you imparted. You know, for me, one example is this. You know, my dad, when he passed away, I think a couple of years back in Malacca here, he left me our home, our family home in Subang Jaya. And you know, my wife was telling me sometimes, you know, we're not going back there, and we're always on the move. Why not just sell that house, lah? After all, Subang Jaya, right? You all know, right? Subang Jaya, real estate, not bad, lah. And I look at her and say, over my dead body. Yeah, you come to the house, let me show you. It's not a house, you know. Let me show you the staircase underneath. This, under the staircase, that's where I used to play when I was Irwin's age. That's where I used to hide under and play. Let me show you my bedroom, the parquet flooring. You see this tile that always come out missing? You know, sometimes I like to hide things under there. Let me show you the bedroom. This is, you know, it's not just a monument. It's memories. It's alive, inspiring memories. Memories that shape me to be who I am. Of course, I know lah. After I die, my children will get rid of it lah, because they have no memories there. And by the time I go back there, it'll be old. And I told my wife, when I'm old and feeble, I'm going to retire there. So I don't care where I get sent all over the world, all over Malaysia. When I die and old and feeble, I'm old and feeble, I'm going to retire there and I'm going to die there. After that, you can do whatever you want. Because to you, it's a lifeless monument. But to me, it's a home. It's memories. So the first friends, don't leave lifeless monuments. Leave memories. Life-inspiring memories. The second way we leave irresponsible legacies is by missing our sphere of influence. By missing our sphere of influence. What do I mean by that? Last week, I already mentioned to you this. Last week, I mentioned this. You know, when we talk about life, all of us have a sphere of influence, meaning people whom our life will influence, whether you like to or not, it will influence these people. Just like Jesus, he had a sphere of influence. And the first sphere is what I call the inner circle. He had his disciples, his family who was with him 24/7. He eat with them, he sleep with them, he taught them, he teach them. They were the closest to him, his family. And all of us, we have this inner circle. Okay, you can go to the next slide. The inner circle. There is our family. We all have that. And Jesus had that. And we have this inner circle. And we have this close family and friends. And all of us will have that. And this will be our primary responsibility. But many times, oftentimes we forget there is another wider circle. And that is what I call the 120, your 120. Because you see, when Jesus died, after Jesus was rose from the dead, and in the book of Acts, when the disciples were gathered, and they were choosing a new disciple, and they were discussing, the Bible tells us, you know, they said, we must choose among those who were with us from the day Jesus started the ministry until now. You know, there were 120 people in the house. You know, there are people who we are always in regular contact with. You know, they may not be our family. They may not be our close friends. But they are people that our lives are always in regular contact. It could be our colleagues. It could be our church members. It could be our neighbors. It could be our wider group of friends. Whatever it is, there are people. There are 120. Our 120 are people. Not exactly 120 lah. But our 120 are people who we are always in connection with. We are regularly in contact with. And our lives will influence them. And finally, there is the multitudes. The multitudes are people that you don't know, but they know you. Your life will still influence them. You don't know who they are. And now, not everybody has the multitudes. Some do. Depends on our vocation, depends on our calling. Many of us, we do have multitudes. People like teachers, people in public office. Even for us as pastors, there are multitudes. You know, our lives will influence a multitude that's beyond these four walls that I don't even know exist. You know, in Malacca, I know Malacca is a small town, but I will walk in the streets and sometimes I will meet people and they will come and tell me, oh, you are pastor. Yeah, I saw you before in some pastor's fellowship, like in some hotel, like in some event. Like. I say, okay, thank you. And thank God I behaved well that time. And don't think it's just Malaysia, you know. I went with my wife to, where were we that time, Melbourne or Brisbane or somewhere on honeymoon, and lo and behold, on the streets, we also meet a member. We meet someone who recognizes, hey, you're a pastor, right? Somewhere in Perth or in Melbourne, I can't remember where. But we do not know. There's an influence to a multitude that we do not know of. And some of us, our lives will impact a multitude. And now this is how we leave irresponsible legacies, friends. That many of us, sometimes, we tend to leave a good legacy to one group of people and we neglect the rest. consciously or unconsciously, we neglect the rest. I read this story once and it really touched my heart. It was a story of a funeral. A pastor who had pastored a church for many, many years was old and he finally died. And when the funeral was being held, it's like in our church here, the casket is here, and people will start coming up and they start giving eulogies about the pastor. And one after another church member, church leader would come up and tell how this pastor was so loving to their family. They would tell about how this pastor was like a father to them when they had no father. So they would tell about how this pastor was there whenever they had a need. About how this pastor was there to help them raise their children. It's like a second father to them. And they would heap testimony about how great this pastor, how loving, how caring, how always being there he was. And the family was just seated there. The mother, the children, the teenage children. And they were looking at this. And when they finally got home, the children gathered around the mother and asked the mother, "Mother, who was that stranger the church members were talking about? Who was that man? Because at home, we never see him. They talk about him being so loving, but we've never seen him loving at home. He talk about how he's so caring and being there. Who was that stranger?" And the mother just told the children, look at the children and told them, "Yes, your father was a good pastor to the church, but he neglected the family." And when I read that, friends, I tell you, it pierced my heart. And I told myself from that day, I will never, ever want my children to say that. I will never, ever want my family to say that. That on the day I die, and when the church members will say about what a good pastor I was, and the children will go home and say, "Who is that stranger? Who is that stranger?" And sometimes we leave legacies like that. We can leave a legacy that is so well to our 120. You know, we can leave a legacy that is so well to our in our corporate office, in our industry. Everybody in the industry knows your name because you're so well in that industry and you leave such a good legacy there. But what about the inner circle? Or some does it in the reverse order. Some people will leave such a good legacy in the inner circle and the world out there looks at him as a crook and a murderer and a thief. Very good example, the mafia. You know, the mafia is one of the most, you know, very, very, very funny people that, you know, when I study, I just like to read about it. You know, they're very weird people, you know. They can be so faithful in church. They can be so generous in church. And not only that, they will love their family. They will give the best to their family. They will play with the children. They will spend time with the family. They will be a loving father, a loving husband, a loving in the family, a loving son. But in the world, they are murderers. They are bank robbers, they torture, they kill, they rape. But in the home, they are a different person. Friends, that's not the way to leave a legacy. You know? And David was one example of this irresponsibility. You know, we saw David's life. He left a wonderful legacy among the 120 that he had. People were willing to die for him. His mighty men, you read the Bible, people were willing to die for him, to give their life for David because he was such a great influence to them. But we know David had not a single child that followed the Lord. Not a single son of David was right in the eyes of the Lord at the end of the day. David somehow was a good influence to his 120 and to the multitudes, to the nation of Israel, to the whole Bible, even to today. But he was a bad influence to his inner circle. But friends, when you look at the life of Jesus, now that was one life we need to emulate. Because Jesus, not only was he an influence to his disciples, his inner circle, that 120 followed him. He influenced the 120 until the day he died, and he influenced the multitude. You see, friends, what happened to most of us is this. Many times when we try to leave legacies on our own, when we try to do our own, I'll talk about this next week, how to leave a right legacy. But many times when we don't try to do it in the right way, what happens many times is this. We will end up leaving legacies only to a certain groups in our life, and we'll be a complete different person in the other group. And that's not the legacies that we are called to live. And so, friends, the first way of leaving a bad legacy is by leaving lifeless monuments. The second way is by missing our sphere of influence. We just leave a legacy to one, but we forget the rest. And thirdly, friends, is by leaving a legend of ourselves rather than a testament of God. By leaving a legend of ourselves rather than a testament of God. You see, friends, many times those trying to leave a legacy, those trying to leave a legend, are people who are trying to leave things about myself. When I leave this world, I want people to remember how great I was, how good I've done, how clever I am, how loving I am, and that's what a legend is all about. It is all about me. Instead, friends, we're not called to leave legends. We are called to leave a legacy for God. A legacy of God. Of God's work in our lives. And our lives are to influence others, not for ourselves, so that people will think of us so great when we leave, but people will be able to be influenced for God's glory. And that's where many people miss it, friends. Many people don't get it right. And many people, you know, and if you don't get it right, what happens is this, that all your effort will be to leave a name for yourself, all your legends and all your deeds, and ultimately at the end of the day, your life does not glorify God. It doesn't glorify God. One example of this is the book of Judges, the life of Samson. If you remember Samson, he was blessed by God. He was blessed by God like no any other man in history was blessed. But yet, despite all that blessing, Samson did not use that for God's glory. He used it to further himself. He attacked the Philistines for what? Because he wanted to marry someone. He attacked the Philistines a second time. Why? Because the wife jilted him, or the wife was given to someone else. And he attacked the Philistines a third time. Why? Because of the wife. Then later on, we know the story of him and Delilah and everything else that went on. His whole life was just about himself, building a name for himself. And we know how Samson's life ended. And even when he died, you know, the Bible tells us he was telling God, Lord, let me die. And let me die for what reason? To take vengeance on the Philistines because they blinded him. And he killed all the Philistines. His life was just a legend for himself, but not a testament to God. Today, friends, whether it be among your relatives, your family, whether it is in your organization, whether it's your work, your school, your career, your industry, if you want to be a famous person, a legend in your field, then you are working towards leaving a legend of your life and not a testimony of God. And this is becoming very prevalent. A lot of people are going that way. Why? You know, a Pew Research has done. They did a survey of the next generation. And you know, they've discovered what? They asked the new generation, what is most important, your most important goal in life? Number one, 80-something percent says to be rich. Number two, 50-over percent says to be famous. In fact, another survey was conducted said this, that among the next generation, 30% would rather be famous than become a lawyer or a doctor. A quarter of them would quit their jobs to become famous. One out of six are willing to cut off ties with their families in order to become famous. And one out of 10 would rather be famous than go to college. And friends, you see, in the world today, the pool of the world is so much that people are trying to be legends in their life. Even in the church, even among Christians, even among pastors, even in our lives, a lot of times the pool is so strong to become legends. And then sometimes it happens because you do a good job, because you excel well in the field that you do, you tend to become a legend. But the question is, friends, what are you consciously trying to leave behind? Are you trying to leave a legend of yourself, or are you trying to leave a testament of God? Jesus was a legend, yes. He came and people remembered him for all that he has done. But he didn't come to leave a legend. He never came to promote himself. Look what Jesus says, you know, in John 6, he says, Jesus gave them this answer, I tell you the truth, the Son cannot do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees the Father doing. John 4, 34, he says, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work, not my work, but his work. John 17 verse 4, I've glorified you on earth. I finished the work which you have given to me. You see, Jesus' entire life on earth was not to bring glory to himself or not to live a legend of himself, but to live a testament of God in his life. And that's what Jesus came to do. Friends, if in your organization or in your work or in your life, whatever it is, when you leave, you will be missed. If you leave a legend, when you leave that organization, you will be sorely missed, definitely. It'll be like there'll be a hole, a gaping hole that is left. But your influence won't go beyond you after you have left. But if you leave a legacy of God's testament, that even though you are no longer there, yeah, people may miss you, but that influence will leave behind. It will linger behind and will continue to impact the lives of the people. And that's what Jesus left. He left a gaping hole, yes, but his influence remained for generations to come. May I encourage you, friends, this morning, don't seek to leave a legend of yourself that glorifies yourself, but instead leave the legacy of God's purpose in your life. And that's the epitaph of David, you know. When David died, it says in Acts 13, 33, for David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep. What a great epitaph. You know, that David, after serving the purpose of God for his generation, he fell asleep. That's the epitaph that we should strive for. That we live for the legend, for the glory of God. Remember the tombstone homework I gave you all last week? How many of you actually went home and did that homework? Everybody, how many of you? Only my daughter. Let me ask you this question. Those of you who did it. Look at that list. How much of it is to glorify yourself? And how much of it is to for God's purpose of your life on earth? If you look at your tombstone homework and you see most of it there, it's, I want to be remembered because I've done this, because I'm like this, because I will. Friends, chances are you're on the wrong track. But if your legacy is to leave the purpose of God in your life, then you will leave an influence that will last the generations. How do we leave a godly legacy? We'll talk about that next week. But I just want to close today with a story, the sad story of the Methodist Church. You know, we talk about legacy and legends and all that. What other legacy have we all inherited other than the big one, the Methodist Church? But you know that the Methodist Church, although they may have started off well, but many times we lose sight of what the legacy ought to be. What the legacy of the Methodist Church truly ought to be. We lose sight. And we get distracted by the other things. You know, you talk about monuments. You go to England today, you will find monuments of the Methodist movement. You will find statues of John Wesley. You can find the upper room, his room, bedroom where he stayed. You can find the foundry, the first Methodist church, the first Methodist society. You'll find all sorts of monuments in England about the Methodist church. But sadly, friends, do you know that today, analysts tell you this, that the British Methodist may not last 20 years. That by 20 years' time, the British Methodist is possibly at the risk of closing down altogether. You can leave all the monuments you like, but if you lose sight of the memories, of the life-changing influence, it's useless. Don't talk about England, let's talk about Malaysia. Yalah, we all, banyak building also, ma. We got so much monument. This church itself is a monument. How old is this building? I have no idea. I'm sorry, I'm here 6 years, I have no idea how old this building is. Look at your schools. Sometimes we are so proud that, Pastor, you know, we have Methodist school. And we are so proud. Let me ask you that. Are these lifeless monuments? Or is there life-inspiring influence? We've lost all influence in all our schools, I'll be honest with you. And why are we so proud of the monuments that we leave behind? And we forget the life-changing influence that we ought to have. You talk about your sphere of influence. You know, when the Methodists first started in England, it targeted the poor coal miners. It also targeted, it also influenced the rich parliamentarians like William Wilberforce. It hit everyone. When Methodists first came to Malaysia, it also went. It went to the poor. You talk about your schools. What were your schools for? Your schools were for the poor children who had no education and no chances to go to school. They ministered to them. And we ministered across board to all societies, from the rich to the poor. Today, Methodism is basically a middle class, upper middle class church and nothing else. We only minister to the upper middle class. We have lost that sphere of influence. And not just the community. Let's talk about your children. How many of your children are in a Methodist church? Don't raise your hands. How many of your children are even in church? Lagi, don't raise your hand. But that's the influence that we are leaving behind. Because we lost track about what our legacy ought to be. Finally, the legends. Yeah, we have no lack of legends in the Methodist Church. We have John Wesley, we have Charles Wesley. After all, our church is called what? Wesley Methodist Church. And we keep that legend. In Malaysia, you have no lack of it. You ask any of the older generation, they will tell you about all the list of missionaries like Chalabert, like Dodsworth, like Hawley, and about all this. We have no lack of legends. And we remember all these names. We engrave their names on their pictures and their names on our churches and things like that, on our schools and on our streets. In fact, the church I'm going to, the church address is number 2 Jalan Wesley. They even have a church, a road gazetted by the government as Jalan Wesley. But let me ask you all this question. As much as the legends we have, how many of you remember the testament of God in their life? How many of you remember what their life for God is all about? You remember the legends, but do you remember the legacy of God's work in their life? That is the true legacy to remember, not the legends, but what God, the influence that God has used their life to influence their generation and the generations to come. And so, friends, it's very easy for us to lose sight of the legacy that is left to us. And it's also very easy for us to lose sight of the legacies that we are leaving behind. And may I encourage you, friends, if you're not careful, if you just live life trying your best to succeed in life, and if you're not careful, you will end up leaving just monuments behind, but no memories. You will end up leaving a legacy to maybe one sphere in your life, but not the rest. And worse, you're going to end up leaving just a legend of yourself and not a testament of God. And may I encourage you, friends, to search your heart, to look back and to ask the same question that I asked you last week. What legacy are you leaving behind? What legacy, what influence are you leaving behind? Let us pray. Wonderful Jesus, wonderful Savior, mighty God. Lord, we give you all the praise, all honor and all glory. And this morning we ask once again, Lord, that you search our hearts, O Father God. Help us to see truly the condition, the things that we are doing. And Lord, help us to be honest with ourselves. Help us to see whether or not our lives are leaving a responsible legacy. Or are we just leaving monuments behind that in a few years it will be a lifeless structure and nothing else? Or are we leaving, are we focusing on just one sphere of influence and neglecting the rest? Living a dual lives, one in the family and one in the world? Or are we building a legend for ourselves, a legend for our name and neglecting the testament of God in our lives. Help us, Lord, to know the true state of what we are doing in our lives. Lord, I just commit all of us into your hands. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.